During the 11th century, the Byzantine Empire saw the rise of many talented military commanders. Despite the increasing military and political difficulties the empire faced from the 1040s to 1090s, several men, such as the great Katakallon Korkomenos and Nikephoros Botaniates, rose to the occasion. One of the most prominent of these great 11th century commanders was George Maniakes. The son of Gordelios Maniakes, George's family came from the theme of Anatolikon. He cut a very distinctive figure. Michael Selos, who was a contemporary of George Maniakes, described him in the following way. Michael Selos, Chronographia, Book 6, Paragraph 77. I have seen this man, and I wondered at him, for nature had bestowed on him all the attributes of a man destined to command. He stood 10 feet high, and men who saw him had to look up as if at a hill or the summit of a mountain. There was nothing soft or agreeable about the appearance of Maniakes. As a matter of fact, he was more like a fiery whirlwind, with a voice of thunder and hands strong enough to make walls totter and shake gates of brass. He had the quick movement of a lion, and the scowl on his face was terrible to behold. Everything else about the man was in harmony with these traits, and just what you would expect. Rumour exaggerated his appearance, and the barbarians, to a man, lived in dread of him. Some because they had seen and marvelled, others because they heard frightful tales of his prowess. Others described Maniakes as courageous and a master of generalship, but also quarrelsome. However, whereas some medievals would quake at the coming of the Normans, or Norsemen, these same people cowered at George Maniakes. Nothing is known about Maniakes until AD 1030. He was strategos of Teluch in Cilicia and played an important role after the Emperor Romanus III's blunder at the Battle of Azaz. He was asked by a band of 800 Aleppan soldiers to surrender the city he governed because they said Romanus III had been captured. Maniakes deceived them by pretending to agree to their demands. He gave them provisions and promised to hand over Teluch the next day. The Arabs celebrated their impending accomplishment and drank the night away. As they slept, Maniakes launched a surprise attack on their camp and massacred them. From this victory, he was able to load 280 camels' worth of supplies and sent them to Romanus III, as well as the noses and ears of the Arabs he had slain. Romanus III promoted Maniakes to Catapan of Lower Media for defending Teluch. The following year, Maniakes negotiated for the surrender of the city of Edessa, with its governor, Suleiman ibn al-Kirgi. Maniakes and his men occupied the citadel of Edessa in November or December of 1031. For his cooperation, the Arabian governor was given gifts and lands inside the Eastern Roman Empire. Now in command of the city, George Maniakes then had to defend it against a counterattack by Nasser ad-Dawla ibn Marwan. The Muslims managed to enter the city, but was unable to oust Maniakes, who held the citadel. Ibn Marwan abandoned his attempt and sacked the lower town instead. The buildings were burned, citizens butchered, and loot loaded onto camels. However, the city remained in Roman hands, and its affairs were put in order by the catapan. Maniakes discovered the letters that Jesus Christ is believed to have sent to Abdar V, the Black, King of Osroene. These letters were sent to Constantinople for safekeeping. Maniakes remained in Edessa, and in 1033, he sent 50 pounds of gold to the emperor from the city. The implication is that he had established the city's government and tax collection. Maniakes stayed in Edessa until 1034 and was reassigned to become Doge of Vaspurakan. Eventually, in 1037, the Emperor Michael IV dispatched his brother Stephen and George Maniakes to Italy as Strategos Autocrata of Longobardia. This special command gave Maniakes the power to assemble troops from all over the empire. His mission was to conquer the island of Sicily, which Emperor Basil II had planned to do just before he died in 1025. At the time, Sicily was in the middle of a civil war. The emir, Ahmad al-Akhal, fought his brother, Abu Hafiz. Their sides reflected deep issues over taxation and animosity between African and Sicilian Arabs. As Maniakes assembled his invasion force, the Catapan of Italy, Constantine Upos, attacked the island to aid the Emir of Sicily. Upos's campaign was successful, but the Sicilian Emir was killed and the island was taken over by the Zurids of North Africa. George Maniakes, his second-in-command Michael Spondyles, and the Admiral Stephen arrived in Italy in 1038. The invasion force consisted of the Varangian Guard, which included Harald Hardrada, the future King of Norway who invaded England in 1066. The army consisted of several small mercenary companies of 300 to 500 Normans, as well as Russians and Lombards. The bulk of the army consisted of soldiers drawn from the themes of Anatolikon, Armeniakon, Thraksikion, and Opsikion, as well as others. Once Maniakes crossed the straits and landed on Sicily, the Arabs summoned their forces and were reinforced with an additional 5,000 troops from Africa. They met the Romans at the Battle of Romata, although the exact size of the armies fielded at Romata are not known. John Skylitzes said of the battle in John Skylitzes' Synopsis of History, Chapter 19, Part 16, "There was a fierce battle at Rometta, in which Maniakes most certainly put the Carthaginians to flight. There was so much killing that the river which flowed by overflowed with blood. He proceeded to take 13 Sicilian towns and then little by little to conquer the whole island." From 1038 to 1040, Maniakes slowly conquered almost the whole of Sicily. Maniakes thus restored the island, which had not been in Roman hands since the 9th century. The former provincial capital, Syracuse, was retaken, which still contained a substantial Christian population. As Maniakes conquered Sicilian towns, he built citadels in them to garrison soldiers and assigned reliable governors to prevent rebellion. Through these means, the island seemed to have been largely secured. In 1040, the Emir of Africa, Abdallah ben al-Mu'izz, assembled a new army, which was even larger than before, and travelled to Sicily. The Saracens fought the Romans at the Battle of Troina. Maniakes ordered Stephen to secure the coast to prevent the Saracens escaping after the battle. Meanwhile, Maniakes defeated the Africans and routed them. It is said 5,000 Saracen troops were killed, but the Emir managed to board a small ship and slip through Stephen's blockade. Maniakes, not a subtle man, was furious with Stephen. When they met after the battle, Maniakes shouted at him, calling Stephen a lazy coward who had betrayed the Emperor and struck him on the head with his whip several times. The humiliated Stephen wrote to his brother, John the Orphan of Trophos. He claimed that Maniakes plotted against Michael IV. Maniakes also fell out with his Norman mercenaries over the division of the spoils. It is said he stripped and whipped their commander, Arduin. The Normans mutinied and abandoned the campaign, moving to southern Italy. Maniakes was arrested by officers sent from Constantinople and, together with Basil Theodorakanos, was imprisoned in the capital. Maniakes was replaced by a eunuch called Basil Podiadites. Podiadites was as incompetent as Stephen as a commander. They are said to have both been timid and lazy, and without the brilliance of Maniakes, the local population rebelled. Together with the Saracens of Tunisia, they drove the Romans out of almost the entire island. Only Messina remained in Roman hands thanks to the great Catacallon Corcomenos, who held the city with the soldiers of the Anatolikon theme. George Maniakes was not released from prison until the short reign of Michael V, who appointed Maniakes as Catapan of Italy. Empress Zoe confirmed his appointment after the revolution of 1042, when Michael V was deposed and the Macedonian dynasty restored. Maniakes arrived at Taranto in Italy in April 1042. The situation was dire due to the inexperienced catapan of Italy, Michael Dokianos. Most of southern Italy had fallen under the control of the tenacious Normans. All that remained in Roman hands were the towns of Brindisi, Hydrus, Taranto, and Bari. The rest had gone over to the Normans. To make matters worse, 7,000 Normans supported the rebellion of a man called Argyros, who rampaged around Italy. Argyros assembled his Norman allies and besieged Taranto. They tried to provoke Maniakes into sallying forth from the city to attack them in the field, but failed. Unable to prise Maniakes from his stronghold, the Normans ravaged the area around Oria and returned home. In June, Maniakes and his troops marched to Matera during the night and had 200 of the inhabitants executed. He then marched to Monopolis and conducted another mass execution to punish the populace for defecting to the Normans. He then launched a campaign that saw the reconquest of Capua, Benevento, and Naples. A modicum of order was restored in the province. Many Normans joined this formidable Byzantine giant who righted those wronged by Dokianos. Although Maniakes had shown great military skill in recovering the situation in Italy, he maintained order with a tyrant's iron fist. Meanwhile, in Constantinople, Zoe married Constantine Monomachos, who now became the senior emperor. The ascension of the emperor was very bad news for George Maniakes. As a landowner in the Anatolicon theme, Maniakes' lands abutted those of Romanus Scleros, both of whom loathed each other. In the past, Scleros had even tried to have Maniakes murdered. Since Scleros' sister, Maria Sclerina, was the mistress of Constantine IX and had influence over him, Maniakes' position was jeopardized. Romanus took the opportunity to pillage Maniakes' estates in Anatolia and raped Maniakes' wife. Romanus Scleros persuaded Constantine IX Monomachos to relieve George Maniakes of his command and change strategies. Constantine IX wanted to bribe Argyros into abandoning his rebellion and sent Pardos the Protos Betharios to replace Maniakes' catapan. Maniakes burned with rage at Scleros' crimes and at the relief of his command. In October 1042, he killed Pardos and proclaimed himself emperor. Maniakes likely already planned to rebel before Pardos arrived because he feared that he would be arrested or mistreated again. He assembled his loyal troops, which included a company of Albanian soldiers and Norman knights, and marched to Bari. However, the Byzantine capital of Italy refused to obey his orders, and so he returned to Taranto. If he wanted to be taken seriously, he had to take Constantinople. Maniakes crossed the Adriatic Sea and landed at Dyrrachium in February 1043. He travelled through the Dukaton of Bulgaria and defeated a loyalist army. Meanwhile, Emperor Constantine IX sent an offer of amnesty to Maniakes, but he refused. The die was cast. The rebel marched to Thessalonica. In March 1043, Constantine IX dispatched a huge army to defeat the usurper. He would have led the army himself had he not suffered from gout. At the Battle of Ostrovo, the loyalist army commanded by Stephen Pergamenos, one of Monomachus's eunuchs, and the army of Maniakes fought each other. Michael Italiates gives a detailed account of what happened next. Michael Italiates, History, Chapter 5, Part 1. Late in the evening, he attacked the great imperial army, for the general whom the emperor had sent out with the Roman army was arrayed against him. He inflicted much damage on the imperial soldiers, and his irresistible charge terrified them no less than the blows that he struck with his own hands. For he fought in person, ahead of his own ranks, in the most dangerous position, and no one could be wounded by his sword without being cut in half, or losing even more of one's body. He was known to be invincible and steady in battle, tall and broad-shouldered. He was terrifying to behold and also exceptionally clever. He was, in fact, on the verge of winning a victory there, and even being acclaimed as emperor by most of the enemy soldiers, when he inexplicably collapsed from atop his horse towards the end of the battle. Such is the will of God, and lay on the ground unmolested, for his opponents thought that this was some kind of trick or stratagem. But when the truth became known, many ran over and found him lying upon the ground drenched in blood, a mortal wound in his side. With his collapse, his army scattered, and victory inclined now to the other side. The imperial soldiers surged back in a mixture of joy and fear, as in stories. They did not boast in victory, but ascribed everything to the hand of God. Michael Selos gives a similar account of the Battle of Ostrovo. Michael Selos, Chronographia, Book 6, Part 84-85. The imperial forces were slow in drawing up their battle line, and once they were in position, they were much more concerned to watch Maniakes himself than take part in actual fighting, although most of them never had a chance of seeing him, because he moved too fast. Thundering out words of command, riding up and down his ranks, he struck terror at once into the hearts of everyone who saw him, and his proud bearing overwhelmed our vast numbers from the very start. Nevertheless, he met his downfall in one of those acts of God, the reasons for which are beyond our ken. He was circling round our legions, spreading confusion everywhere. He had only to attack, and the serried ranks gave way. The solid wall of troops withdrew. Indeed, our whole army was being broken into groups and destroyed. Then suddenly he was hit in the right side. It was not a superficial wound, and the blood flowed freely at once from the deep gash. Apparently, he was unaware of the blow at first, but when he saw the trickle of blood, he tried to staunch it with his hand. He realized he had been mortally wounded, and in sheer desperation, tried to regain his own lines. He did, in fact, get some little way from our army, but he was now unable to turn his horse's head. His body had lost all strength, and he was fainting. He gave a gentle moan, a last gesture, dropped his reins, and slid out of his saddle to the ground. A pitiable sight. Even when our men saw him lying there, they did not recover their bravery. They still reined in their charges, for fear lest the enemy were planning an ambush. However, as Maniakes' attendant squire was some distance away, and his horse free to roam now, cantered up and down the space between the two armies. All of them, in one great mob, rushed up to the body. The sight that met their eyes was astounding. So great was the area of ground covered by that sprawling corpse. The head they cut off and brought it back to their own general, whereupon a host of men claimed to have killed him. Descriptions of the murder were supplied as invention or imagination dictated, but since it was impossible to demonstrate the truth of these stories, they invented another, to the effect that certain unknown horsemen had fallen upon him and cut off his head. Many such accounts were fabricated, without any convincing evidence. On the other hand, they did claim, from the fact that he was wounded in the side, that the weapon must have been a lance. Yet the man who inflicted the wound was still unknown, right up to the day when I wrote this history. Maniakes' army surrendered soon after the death of their commander. Stephen celebrated a triumph in Constantinople for defeating the usurper with the severed head of Maniakes held aloft on the top of a spear. Later, Maniakes' head was displayed in the hippodrome as a warning to future traitors. A young Michael Selos wrote and recited an oration in Constantine IX's honour. It surveyed the history of the empire from the death of Basil II to the death of George Maniakes. The career of George Maniakes lasted for 13 years from 1030 to 1043. He had risen through the ranks through his own merit and was a peerless general. However, he was a wrathful man and had no political acumen. Thus, it is difficult to judge how well he would have ruled had he been emperor. One of the few usurpers of Byzantine history who came so closely within reach of that goal. Unlike most usurpers who were usually written off by contemporary historians with hardly a good word to say about them, Most Byzantines saw George Maniakes as a hero, or at the very least, admired the man. He had defended Teluch in the aftermath of the Battle of Azaz, taken and held Edessa from the Arabs, conquered Sicily, stabilized the situation in Italy, and nearly managed to defeat the imperial army and become emperor. Christopher of Mytilene later wrote an epitaph for George Maniakes that said, "His prowess was in the tomb with him, as it lived on in his muscles and refused to revive as a separate body from his." If you enjoyed this video, please do remember to like and subscribe, and this has been Eastern Roman History.